My name is John Renesch. I'm a co-founder of FutureShapers. I'm usually in that seat. Tom and I decided to switch because I've been under the weather a bit the last week, and I might resort to a lot of coughing, which would not be good, really good for either the audio or the video. A little bit about FutureShapers before I introduce Tom. FutureShapers offers executive peer groups, we call them roundtables, which are for people that are interested in becoming more conscious as leaders and that want to be part of a peer group and be facilitated by a professional coach. And it takes a one-year commitment. And we also offer consciousness coaching, one-on-one consciousness coaching. We have a team of 10 consciousness coaches, mostly people long in the tooth like me, that have been around a while. We want to thank also Gladstone for the use of this incredible facility. So with that, I'm going to sit down in the audience, which will be different for me, and turn it over to Tom Eddington, my partner in FutureShapers and CEO of FutureShapers, and he can introduce Susan Mayginnes, our guest for tonight.
Thank you, John. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us this evening.
So, Susan.
Yes.
Let's talk a little bit about you and your work, and I'd like to start by just having you describe how you think about conscious leadership, and when I use the term conscious leadership, what does that mean for you?
Okay. I'd actually like to kind of jump into that without coming up with sort of the next cool definition of that. Instead, I'd like to just reference, I just happened to pick up a book I'd read a long time ago the other day, and it was about a study that was done. This is back in the 80s, and this was when they were forming what became the American Leadership Forum, and the American Leadership Forum was founded by Joe Jaworski, Harlan Cleveland, Warren Benesch. These were like the big league players in the world on leadership back in the 80s that were doing all this research and amazing work with leaders. I'm sure you've heard of many of these names. Yep. And I was reading through their findings, and they had this list of the problem with American leaders. Okay, this is back in the 80s. The problem with America, and this may sound familiar to you, which is why I'm bringing it up. But the number one problem with American leaders was, what do you think? What would you guess? What would you guess? What would be the number one problem with American leaders?
Short-term focus.
Okay, so that's certainly a legitimate offering, but that was not what they found was the number one problem. The number one problem with American leaders was their lack of self-knowledge. The number one problem, their lack of self-knowledge. I mean, that's a pretty big statement. So if you think about what is conscious leadership, I mean, starting with that, I mean, if you're going to be leading people, and you're going to be having an impact in the world, and you're going to be being of influence to other people, don't you think it would be a good idea to know who you are? I mean, that would be a good starting place. So starting with that, I would have to say, and I would, by the way, I think if the study was done today in 2016, the answer would be the same. The number one problem with American leaders is their lack of self-knowledge. So what does that mean? So part of becoming a leader and being a person of influence really means to understand yourself in a deep way, to understand not just your habits and not just understand what you like and what you dislike, not just understand what you want to do in the world and create in the world, but to understand yourself from the interior, to understand how you think, what motivates you, what drives you, what are the patterns that you operate out of, what inspires you and what demotivates you, and what it is that you really want to make happen in the world and why. So this is a deeper dig into really understanding yourself, and it's a very good starting place for leadership. The number two thing that they said about what is the problem with American leaders The number two thing was their lack of awareness of values. Lack of awareness of values. And I think even though there is more conversation in the world today, I mean, go on the internet and you'll find lots of conversations that are happening about values. But if you walk up to, and I know you've worked in corporations all over the world and, you know, large and small corporations, if you walk up to an employee at any level in an organization, including the leadership of the organization, and you say, what are the values of this company? You will be surprised at how many people are completely unable to answer that question. I mean, if you even go back to Enron, the leadership of that organization had described their fundamental values as being honesty, integrity, and something like that. Honesty, you know, but nobody knew that.
Well, it was on their laminated card.
It was on their laminated card, and it was, and in fact, I was at this airport in Colorado, I think it was in Colorado Springs, and there was like a place where you could get some food, like a kind of a fast food Asian food place. And as I was standing there ordering my food, there had this plaque on the wall. And the plaque on the wall was their mission statement. And it was a beautiful mission. I mean, I thought, wow, this is really cool. I mean, you know, this Asian fast food restaurant in an airport, and they've got this really cool mission statement that obviously a number of people had spent some time really crafting and getting the wording down and the concepts, and it was really well done. And I said to the girl behind the counter, I said, I love your mission statement. And she looked at me and she said, what?
We're all out of that today.
Do you want that with rice? And I said, your mission statement, it's really well stated. And she said, what? You know, she was just completely confused. And I pointed to the plaque on the wall. And I realized at that moment, it was the first time she was seeing it. And she worked there every day. And she went, oh, what is the, yeah. And then she started to read it. And then she kind of went, okay. You know, so there's this lack of real investment in values and lack of conversation. Even if there are values, there's a lack of conversation that really brings that forward into the world. So that was number two. Number three, the problem with American leaders is their lack of knowledge on how to actually create change. How to create change. And have you ever read the book Deep Change by Robert Quinn? Have you read that?
I haven't.
No. Fabulous book, by the way, for those of you who love conscious leadership, one of the best books that I've read on the subject. But Robert Quinn was a professor at MIT who did MIT Business School, who also was a change agent in the world and did, you know, large scale culture change, which I'm sure you've done.
Yep,
you've done those,
absolutely.
I've done those. And of course, one of the things that they found when they researched this was 70% of all culture change initiatives fail. 70%. Okay, now, if I was a betting person and somebody came to me and said, hey, we want to generate a culture change and it's going to cost you a few million dollars, if I was a betting person, I would say that's a bad expenditure. It's a bad way to spend my money as a business leader. But all these companies were doing amazing efforts to generate culture change and with very little success. So what Robert Quinn did was he wanted to understand, why is this? So he went around and he interviewed over 3,000 employees at all levels of an organization, at the top, in the middle, at the bottom, to find out what's the problem here. You know, why did this culture change fail? And actually, that was the only question he asked. So he did this interview, but he didn't ask a series of questions. He asked this one question: why did this culture change fail? And he asked everybody. And here's what he heard. Well, you know, it failed because management didn't really do any of the things. They didn't really change anything. Or they'd hear, well, the employees really didn't, we tried, but the employees didn't change anything. Or, well, leadership didn't really do anything different. So everybody was basically pointing the finger at everybody else. And what he said was that out of 3,000 people interviewed, not one person, not one, said, well, nothing changed because I didn't change. Nothing changed because I didn't do anything differently. So again, that's, to me, conscious leadership is about how do you show up as a leader if you want to generate change. You know, of course, we know the expression, be the change, right. But really, what does that actually mean? And how do you show up as a leader that generates change? And then the last thing that they discovered, the problem with American leaders, was their lack of awareness of interconnectedness, and that they really talked about and dealt in concepts that separate divisions between things rather than interconnectedness. And so to be a conscious leader in today's world, you know, and this is like a big conversation, you know, John and I have had this conversation because we both run mastermind groups, but a big part of our conversation is this work on really the quantum universe, understanding the quantum universe and understanding neuroscience today. And when you begin to really explore this at a deep level, the way in which we are connected, the web of connection that we live in is quite extraordinary. And if you're going to be a leader in the world and you are not aware of the interconnectedness between you and everything, not just the people that you work with, but really everything in the world, then you are very limited in how you play the game. So, you know, without giving a pat definition of conscious leadership, I think these are beautiful examples of the elements Absolutely. Of what it takes to be a conscious leader and what you need to be aware of in the world, yourself, your interconnectedness, the values that you operate out of, and like that, yeah.
Well said. What you shared is very similar to how we think about it. Future Shapers, we think about conscious leadership, the self-awareness piece and the actions that you take based on the self-awareness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Again, it's you've worked with leaders. I know John has. I have worked with leaders, and that ability to really question yourself deeply as a leader and look at what is showing up in your world and be able to make the connection between yourself and how things are showing up in your business and in your company. If you cannot make that fundamental equation, then you've got a problem.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So can you talk a little bit about how you're bringing that information into the work that you do and the work that you do?
Well, sure, I can talk about that. So in for many years, back in 1976, I started a company called the Summit Organization with two friends of mine. We co-founded this organization, and it was a personal and professional development company. So we did this work in the format of workshops, seminars, trainings. This was very 70s way, very 70s model of how people were becoming conscious at the time, where it was through workshops and seminars and that kind of thing. So we had a company. We grew it to about a $14 million company at the time. Without any help from the internet or like that. It was just out on the street. And had about 40,000 people that went through those programs. And so that was in my background, that was my initial experience about how do you start to generate the conscious conversation and really begin to impact people. And at that time, this was, of course, in the middle of the whole high-tech boom, so we were having all these managers coming through from Apple and Intel, and you know, all these companies were sending managers and leaders, you know, through the organization. So we were starting to work with leaders in that space. Most recently, what I have been looking at is in the model that we've created is a model that is very similar to John's about, and yours, about really bringing leaders together in a conscious way. And what does that mean? It means a combination of things. One is, I think leaders, I think in this world in general, there's an incredible lack of community. I think there's a lot of pseudo community. There's a lot of people that come together for short periods of time to get something from each other or give something to each other, and then they're gone, then they fall apart. And I think there's an incredible amount of loneliness and disconnection in the world. And I think leaders suffer from that maybe more than anyone because they don't have a peer group quite often. I was at an event recently where somebody said, yeah, there's nobody ever creates a nonprofit for people at the top. Like, how do you end suffering? But I think that was, we were kind of laughing about that, but on another level, it really expresses there's a lack of awareness of the suffering that leaders actually experience. And one of the reasons that I wanted to create the mastermind group was because in my work, I found that leaders were some of the most suffering people I'd ever met. Stressed out, their marriages were compromised, their kids were a mess. Their health was incredibly compromised. I mean, people really suffering from a lot of psychological, emotional, spiritual distress, even if they had a ton of money. You know, this spiritual, psychological, social distress was incredible. And I thought, there has to be a better way to be a leader. There has to be a better way to do leadership. And how do we bring these people together to really support each other in that process and have a more conscious conversation? How do we keep each other awake in the process of everything that you have to face as a leader? The opportunities, the challenges, the distractions, what pulls us as human beings, greed, all those things that we are as human beings. How do we keep each other conscious if we're going to be doing this as leaders in the world? So that was it, was to create a peer group of people that could really support each other in that journey. And we do personal development work. We do a very deep dive into really understanding, like what you were talking about, understanding yourself psychologically, emotionally, energetically. Mm-hmm. What does that even mean? I mean, most people never even think of that. They understand there's a psychological self, but there's an energetic self. What's that? You know, and it really, the way we talk about it is that everyone is on a journey, right? We're all on a journey, but there's two journeys that are going on. One is the outer journey, and one is the inner journey. So there's an outer game that we're playing, which is about, you know, how do we grow our business, and how do we meet these goals, and how do we increase profit, and how do, you know, all those things. That's like the outer game, and all of our strategies for doing that and our tactics. But there's an inner game that's going on as well. And if you are not, as a leader, if you are not attuned to your inner game, you're going to struggle very deeply with your outer game, because those have to be congruent. Mm-hmm. Those have to be congruent. So what we talk about is your way of being in the world. What is your way of being? We talk, you know, you think about, okay, what am I doing? Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm going to do, we're so doing, or, oh my God, you know, just as a culture, frighteningly so, we're so doing oriented. And it's not that there aren't things to do. I'm sure we've all got a ton of stuff that we could be doing instead of this right now, but for some reason you're here. But there's this ongoing doingness, but there's a different conversation that is really about, who are you being in everything that you do? How are you showing up in everything that you do? And that's a very big part of our conversation, of looking at what is your way of being in the world, and what does that even mean? how am I being, who am I being in this conversation, and to actually choose that intentionally, volitionally, consciously, choose that, and then be able to show up in the world in a particular way.
And I had a chance to spend some time on your website, and you've got a number of testimonials of leaders who have been in your mastermind groups, mm-hmm. and they've gone through the experience, and they talk about the impact it's had on their business in terms of bottom line growth and profitability. Can you talk a bit about what you see in the leaders in terms of their personal journey, mm-hmm. and how they make the transformation?
Yeah, so there's a couple things. I mean, one is, one of the things that we work with is underlying beliefs. So there is a very big connection mm-hmm. between the way that the world is unfolding for you and what you are able to accomplish and not able to accomplish, and how that relates to the fundamental foundational beliefs that you operate out of. Now, I'm not just talking about the beliefs that, like, if I say to you, write down everything you believe about money, write down everything you believe about business, write down everything you believe about men, write down what you believe about women, write down what you believe about yourself. You would only be able to tell me what you consciously know that you believe or think that you believe. There's a deeper look at that, which is to really go into understanding what it is that you fundamentally believe, which means this is the water you swim in. These are the basic assumptions that shape the way in which you see the world, and therefore the way in which the world occurs for you, and therefore the way in which you show up and play the game in the world. So we look deeply. We do a whole body of work that's about really looking at that very deeply, and then we have a number of different strategies, technologies, methods that are about how do you shift these beliefs at a fundamental level so that it actually creates a different brain pattern. Because when you're operating out of a fundamental mm-hmm. belief, if we were to actually look at a brain scan, it would look a particular way. And when you shift that at a really fundamental level, and you look at the brain scan, it is absolutely different. And this has been proven and tested again and again. So we actually do this work, which is about how do you begin to shift the beliefs that you operate out of, and first of all, become aware of what you're operating out of, and then how do you begin to change mm-hmm. that, truly change that, because we've all had insights, and we love insights. We love insights. We love those aha moments. Aha, I see, you know, this is how this is happening. This is why this is happening. We love insight. And insight's great. I'm a fan. And yet, we've all had insights about why or how we're constructing certain things in our life, and yet nothing changes, right? How many people can relate to that, right? Okay, we've all like, oh, yeah, I really see this, and here I am doing it again, and I don't even believe it, but I'm saying this stuff again, you know? So we find ourselves going down that same path. They're like, why? But I looked at this, and I understand this. Why am I still doing this? And it drives us nuts. So this work that we do is about how do you address this more truly, more deeply, so that you can actually shift the pattern, and then something organically begins to change. You find that pattern just begins to fade out, or if it shows up, it just doesn't have much of a grip.
So the insights around their beliefs.
Mm-hmm. And underlying beliefs. And then, again, a lot about, we look at, you know, business strategies and things that people want to accomplish, and there's a lot of collaboration in the group about, like, how people can accomplish particular things. But again, coming back to the conscious leadership mm-hmm. piece, so much is about your way of being in the world. Like, if the focus is strictly on what you're doing, you are coming up so short, I can't even begin to tell you how short you're coming up, but you are really not getting the full impact of what you can actually generate without being a particular way that is congruent with what it is that you want to generate. And so that is a lot of the work that we do, is where something is not happening in your life or in the world. And by the way, when I say your life, it's because we disappear the compartmentalization, the false compartmentalization that we operate out of as people in this, in the conversation in the world, which is, this is my business life, this is my personal life, this is my relationship, this is my parenting life, this is, and actually it's one life. It's one life. We like to think it's compartmentalized. It's not. You know it, I know it, and as Bob Dole used to say, and the American people know it. So we all know that it's not really true, because we don't experience our life that way. We experience our life as our life. So in our mastermind group, all conversations are welcome. All conversations. We talk about feelings. We talk about parenting. We talk about people's relationship with their spouse, because all of it affects everything. You know, if you squeeze an orange, you get orange juice. And you get orange juice whether you're in a relationship, whether you're at work, you get it. I mean, it's orange juice. You know, so who you are is who you are. And there's ways that you show up that that are incongruent with what it is that you want to generate. So that's a lot of what the work is that we do. Yeah.
So as you're taking people through that process, at what point do they have a transformation or become self-aware of how they've been showing up, mm-hmm. how they've been being versus how other people are experiencing mm-hmm. their being?
Mm-hmm. Day three. No. when? I'd say that's really different for mm-hmm. everybody, because there's an ongoing conversation. We have an opening retreat that we do where all I can say is a lot is revealed in that, it just even in the first weekend, it's like really having people see, just begin to see below the surface mm-hmm. of, you know, I'm operating here, but really there's a lot of other stuff that's going on beyond, you know, we talk about hardware, you know, there's in the culture today, there's this big computer metaphor. It's like, well, this is my hardware, but really what's on my software is this. Well, it's so far beyond hardware and software. There's so much more that's going on beyond that, that it's really looking very deeply at what it means to be a human being,
right.
and what are all of the influencers of that, and what are all the components and the complexity of that, and how do you begin to impact that intentionally.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So are there particular exercises, particular work that you're doing with folks to help them see that reflection in the mirror?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of, every time we get together, the first part of the day, because we meet once a month, we have two retreats during the year, and then we meet once a month for a day. And in the morning, we do some kind of personal reflection, mm-hmm. or just as people are describing what's going on, we support them in looking more deeply at why and how that's actually showing up, which is beginning to look, you know, at these different elements. So, I mean, in terms of exercises, there's things we do every year, and every year is different mm-hmm. than the previous year, because we really orient what we do around what the group needs, what mm-hmm. everybody in the group actually needs. So we're not like doing an off-the-shelf program where we do the same activities every time. It's really different because people are in a different space, and we may repeat something if that's what's needed,
right.
but it's very organized around, you know, what it is that people need. Mm. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So pre-1976, what happened in your life, or what got you on this path of focusing on the work that you've been doing?
Yeah, well, there's a story. so, you know, there's like these pivotal moments in your life, right? You look back and you go, wow, that was the moment where I was going down this road, and all of a sudden I took that fork in the road and it went in a different direction. And in 1976, I was in college. And I was a very good student, 4.0 student, doing great, all of that. And I absolutely was having an existential crisis, and knew that there was nothing that I was learning in school that was answering any of the questions that I had about life. And I liked school. I mean, you know, I always did well in it. I liked my friends. I liked my teachers. The curriculum was relatively interesting, but nothing was hitting home. And I remember this one day, it was finals week, right? And on this one particular day, I had several finals. And the first one started at 10:30 in the morning. And I was sitting at my dining room table. And I was looking at the clock, just right over there, just right on the wall across from the table. And I knew I needed to leave the house by 10 o'clock in order to get to school on time to be at finals. And I watched the clock go past 9:30 and 9:45, and then it was 5 to 10, and then it was 10 o'clock, and then it was 10:05, and then it was... And I couldn't move. I couldn't move. And I just sat there and watched the clock. And then 10:30 went by, and I went, okay. And I didn't know what it meant, but the phone rang at that moment. Okay, now there's a timing in the universe that even when you're some unconscious 21-year-old kid who doesn't know anything, the phone rang and I picked up the phone and it was a friend of mine who was letting me know about a seminar, right, a workshop that was going on in San Francisco. And she called and she said, I want you to know that Paul, this mutual friend, is going to be doing a workshop. And I said, okay. And she said, do you want to do it? And again, I'm sort of, I just blew off my entire college career. I'm sitting there, I got nothing. I got nothing. Sure, I'll sign up. And I went, and that became my career for the next 18 years. Because that was my first foray really into consciousness. And I partnered with Paul, with this other friend of mine, and that was the beginning of what became the Summit Organization. Mm. But it was that moment of sitting there with, I had no idea what I was going to do or what I was going to create, but I knew that the road I was going down was not it. And it wasn't until 18 years later that I actually went back and finished a master's degree and did all that, but it was all kind of after the fact.
Yeah. And looking back, do you have a sense now of what was going on in your brain in that moment, in your life in that moment?
Well, in my brain, what was going on was very little. But, I think there's a certain mystery. Mm. I really do. I think there's a certain mystery to things. And I don't hope to ever really answer some of those questions. Yeah. But I knew that I couldn't do what I was doing, and I had to let go. I needed to let go. And what was interesting is that a lot of times we know we need to let go, and there's this process of, okay, I got to let go. Do we have to go through this whole letting go process? But in that moment, the letting go happened. Mm-hmm. Like I felt like my life let go of me rather than I let go of it. And in that letting go, there was an opening. Mm-hmm. And in that opening, something else could come in that apparently was meant to come in, because it really became my life, my adult life path. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And looking back on it, any sense that there were indications that that morning was going to unfold that way?
No, actually, you know, I don't remember anything that was going on before that at all. I mean, if I sort of look back in my memory, and memory, as we know, is a poor test of reality, but I kind of look back on it, I just sort of see myself in school kind of doing my thing and having normal, you know, sort of kid fun. But just really this sense of a real lack of fulfillment, mm-hmm. or a lack of a sense of meaning.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's a big part, you know, coming back to the conversation about conscious leadership. I think people who are operating in the world as conscious leaders are really very purpose-driven. They really are operating from a sense of, you know, what is meaningful, what is deeply meaningful to them. And some people kind of convey that naturally, you know, or again, they just know. Mm. But most people don't. Most people don't. I mean, they can sort of answer it superficially, but to go deeply into that question for yourself and to really consider for yourself what matters to you and how you want to live your life and what is the contribution that you want to make and also what is it that you feel called to do in the world? What do you feel called to bring is a really important look into your own interior to really understand that. Otherwise, you may find yourself always operating over somebody else's agenda for you that you don't even realize is somebody else's agenda for you. Mm-hmm. You know, like there's a conversation that people have with themselves all the time, which is, you know, what should I do? You know, what should I do? What should I do in my life? What should I do about this? And the whole should thing kind of takes you down a direction of the whole should thing is based on what you heard from what you heard growing up from your family, from school, from church, from teachers, from society, the world's idea of what you should be and do to be successful. So we start following the path of what should I do. It takes us down a very particular route, which usually is not particularly fulfilling. Mm-hmm. When you start to ask a different question of yourself, which is, what is it that I truly want? Who do I really truly want to be? And you start to follow that, you let that be your journey. It takes you in a very different direction than the conversation about should. And you watch your life unfold in a very different way, but most people don't ask themselves that in a very deep way. It's more kind of surface, well, oh, what do I want, you know, rather than really deeply, what is it that I want in my life?
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Having had that experience, and you, I don't know if you've had any similar experiences since then, how do you bring that into your work when you're working with leaders? And, you know, I suspect we both have found leaders who are stuck at various points in their life, could be in their personal life, their professional life.
I think there's a conversation that happens, you know, at many different points. I mean, I was just having a conversation with if you're familiar with, I don't know if you know Robert Diltz's work, but Robert Diltz is also very, read his books too, they're great. and he is somebody who has studied successful geniuses. He's got 30 books on the subject of successful geniuses, everything from Da Vinci to Steve Jobs to all kinds of people. But one of the things he was talking about, this was like a couple days ago, was leadership moments. This is an interesting thing if you think about it. It's like really we tend to think of leadership as this thing, but really it's characterized by these moments that happen where you need to step into your leadership. So, you know, for all of us who are leaders, you're working, you're at work, you're doing your thing, you're dealing with things that are coming up. But there's these moments where you really need to step in as a leader. And in order to really step in as a leader and to step in effectively as a leader, there's some things you have to have clarity about. Mm-hmm. One is you have to be very clear about what your intention is in that moment. You know, why are you stepping in? What is it that you want to have happen? What is the outcome that you want from this conversation or from your intervention in that moment? Another thing you need to be very clear about is your vision. Like, a leadership moment can be clarifying the vision of the company.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you're building a company, and it's very easy to lose sight of, wait a minute, where are we going? You know, what is the vision? What is it that we're trying to accomplish? So a leader has to be able to step in with a clarity of vision and clarifying the vision at different times. And also, you have to be clear about values, because you have to be aware of when we're on track or off track about, are we showing up in a way as a company, mm-hmm. And individually, that is consistent with who we say we are as a company, with the values. So sometimes it's an intervention that is really course correcting, so that we're acting in a way that's consistent with the values. So this, you know, clarity of what you're there to do, and also clarity about your way of being. Who do you need to be in that moment that's congruent with the effect that you want to change, that you want to have? But if you think about it, like your own leadership, it shows up in these these moments.
Mm-hmm.
So even stuckness is often just the absence of really stepping into that, the moment
right.
that presents itself, and what do you do in that moment to impact something, to make a difference in that moment for your team, for yourself, for your organization.
Hmm.
Yeah.
I think we should go ahead and open it up to the audience and get some questions.
If there are any.
Hello, I'm Joyce Anastasia. It's very good to be here.
Great, thank you for coming.
Thank you for your presentation and dialogue. I am curious how you deal with discerning when a group of leaders come together. They come together initially for a vision of a company, but then they discover that their own integrity is at risk as they go along in the company, mm-hmm. and they get asked to do things that are against their own principles. I'm just curious if you could give us some examples of that and how you maybe both have dealt
mm-hmm.
with that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'd be interested. I'd love to hear your comments on that too. Well, actually, I walked away from a company I helped build because I felt like I had to compromise my integrity to stay there. And that was a very difficult decision. But there wasn't space in that particular situation that I could find in order to generate the level of integrity that mattered most to me. I think nothing happens short of dialogue, short of a conversation. One of the reasons that it's really important in a hiring process for people to be clear about the values that they're coming into the company, that is present in the company that they're coming into, is to see if the values are in fact congruent with their own. Because that's going to be a very hard place to be if the values of the company are in some way fundamentally different than your own, or you can't find a connection between those values and your own. So I think it really starts at the level of hiring and being clear what you're choosing into. And then I think it also depends on the level that you're coming into the company. Is there space in the company for a conversation where you see that the values are inconsistent, or the way something is happening is inconsistent? There are companies that really have space for that dialogue to happen. A great example of that is Zappos. I mean, they publish a book about all their, you know, all their screw-ups every year. I mean, it's like a yearbook they publish. And everybody can comment about, you know, what they loved about the company and where the company was just totally off base. And they want it right out in front where everyone can look at it. I mean, that's some transparency, right? I mean, you got to love that. That's some real integrity to show up with that level of transparency. And there are people who have said, you know, this organization, screw, they don't do this. They say they're about this, but they don't. But they want it because how else do you begin to change that. If you think you're going to create values and that everyone's going to show up perfectly, good luck with that. That's not going to happen. You know, we're all imperfect human beings, and we're all going to be off on any given day about our values. So it's really, how much do we get back on track with that? How much is there space for somebody to say to you, you know, that was really out of integrity.
Right.
Let's get back on track. So am I in an organization where there's room for that? And if not, well, why am I there is a question. And then if you have your reasons for wanting to stay, then how do you manage yourself inside of an organization in which there is that inconsistency? You know, and for how long do you do that? And can you show up in a way that is consistent with your values, your own personal values within the context of that company?
Hmm.
Did you have a particular situation in which you felt compromised?
I left an organization because I was asked to do very unethical things.
Yes, and I think that ultimately becomes the answer. If you're asked to do unethical things, you don't want to do it, there's a conversation about it, and they still want you to do it, and it's like, do it or leave. You know, I remember when I was making that decision to leave in a similar vein, you know, you kind of look at, wow, there's so much I'm giving up to leave. You know, it's like, I mean, if I leave, there's all this money, there's all these relationships, there's all this, but in the end, you know, you got to look yourself in the mirror the next day. And it's like, really, what do I give up? I give up my integrity. I give up myself in order to stay. It's like, nothing's worth that.
Mm.
Nothing's worth that. Yeah.
Yeah, I think there were a couple of examples that came to mind for me. So one, unfortunately, most of the mid and large size organizations I've worked with, the leadership have been in place and the culture is so strong that people lose themselves, the leaders lose themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And they at some point forget what their values are, what their integrity is, and they've absorbed the organization culture, the organizational values, and the organization integrity, and they confuse their personal with the organization, and they completely lose themselves. That's what I've seen most frequently. Mm-hmm. I had an organization I worked with for a number of years. It was an industry leader, and they tended to grow their talent from within, and at some point realized if they were going to survive, they needed to bring talent in from outside the organization. They started recruiting heavily to bring in people from the outside, and within 18 months, those people were leaving. And so I worked with them to interview the folks who left to ask, why did you leave? And consistently, every single leader said, I was brought in because of my experience, my background, my capability, but as soon as I got in the organization, I was undervalued, I wasn't appreciated because nobody knew me, I had no capital, and I wasn't going to stick around in an organization that didn't value what I had to offer.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, a lot of the organizations that are out there, the organizational culture will drive how people show up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There was an interesting article in the Wall Street Journal a couple months ago about how the big financial organizations, Charles Schwab, all these organizations are having a hell of a time recruiting MBAs. Mm-hmm. They cannot get MBAs to work for them because people coming out of business school today, they're looking for more meaning. You know, they're looking for how can I make a contribution, not just how do I make a bunch of rich people richer and just make a big bag of money? I mean, they're actually looking for ways in which they can change the world, do something good, have an impact on, you know, the different problems that exist in the world today, and they're getting or affect technology, and there's so many other options for these people coming out of business school now. These organizations mm-hmm. are actually beginning to look at some of their practices and how do we change and have people feel more valued and generate more meaning and create better conditions for these people to work in, because nobody wants to play that game anymore.
Other questions? Thank you.
I was going to say, and I'm glad I didn't because it wasn't in the top four, but when you asked about problems for leadership, I was going to say courage. Mm. And it's something that's come up with, I think, almost every speaker this question's been asked in one way or another is, how do you help leaders, or how do you help them realize the value of developing that courage to change? Because it's scary, right? You know, especially in public companies, you know, it's about the doing, it's about the stock price, it's about making the quarter. And to say, oh, I'm going to take the long view, I'm going to look at the big picture, is terrifying, because you give up, because other people are going to look at you like, yeah, consciousness, that's cute, but we have to bring in the quarter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so can you talk about
sure.
you know, your experience with kind of helping people down that process
sure.
and helping them find their way through that?
Absolutely. So one of the things that I discovered early on when I transitioned from being somebody who led workshops where people would sign up and come and do that to going into companies is that companies didn't give a shit about consciousness, pardon my language. I mean, it was really not particularly interesting to them. And to come in with that conversation, nobody wanted to play. So what I quickly realized was that people wanted what mattered to them. See, we, you know, if you're sitting here, you're probably somebody who really values the idea of consciousness and all that, everything that goes along with that. If I'm going into an organization that doesn't even know that, what that is, or has ideas about what that means, and by the way, when I first started doing this, I was working with white Southern Baptist bankers in Georgia. So, I mean, I was working with super conservative, where, I mean, these guys were very conservative. And I wouldn't even think of using some of that language there because it would just be considered too far out there. Just the fact that I took vitamins and drank bottled water was outside the reality tunnel, totally. I mean, it was just bizarre to them. So that wasn't ever part of my conversation until much later. But what I really wanted to find out was what mattered to them and what their goals were, because the only way that you create a relationship with anybody is not by coming in with what is of value to you. It's about finding out what is of value to them, what matters to them, and how can you help them to accomplish what they care about, what matters to them. Your only value to somebody is your ability to help them achieve what is of value to them. So that was my conversation. I wanted to find what they wanted, what their goals were, what they was in the way of accomplishing it. And then as they would bring me in, and I had a little team that we kind of went into these companies to work with. As we began to work with them, you know, we would start by having conversations about, you know, things like conflict resolution, things like team building, you know, things like that. However, embedded within that is self-awareness. Is self-aware. I mean, you can't build a team unless I'm aware of what matters to me, what matters to you. So we used the languaging that allowed them to be comfortable with the process of really bringing higher, I called it, we were smuggling higher consciousness, you know, into organizations. But it was really bringing a higher level, a heightened awareness into the organization. And it was finally, when I was working with these bankers in Northern Georgia, it was about a year later that I actually had them doing breath work, like got them all laying on the floor with their belts unbuckled, doing deep belly breathing work, because I was finally able to make a connection between the brain and oxygenating and makes you smarter. I mean, you have to use, you know, scientific. and also meditation. They were meditating. I mean, these guys, they were meditating. They were meditating. They were doing mindfulness stuff. I mean, but it took a year of being in there to be able to bring it. And I even remember the day I introduced meditation, and I introduced it in a very simple way. At the break, the CEO of the holding company, so these were 16 presidents and vice presidents of 17 different banks, and the CEO and COO of the holding company that held these banks. And the CEO is a very authoritative guy, big guy, very authoritative. And he comes over to me on the break and he goes, You got any tapes on that meditation stuff? And I said, yeah, I think I've got some stuff for you if you're interested. He goes, well, send it to me. I walked away. He became a meditator. He eventually left the organization, went off and kind of lived his dream life. But it's really bringing it in a way that people can, that makes sense. It has to make sense to them. Can't just say, hey, I'm going to bring consciousness into your organization. Isn't that great? I mean, nobody cares. They care about what will help me meet my goals and my quarterlies and, you know, make the money and the profit. And so that really becomes the way to do that and to do it ethically.
Thank you.
Thank you for the question.
How did they change?
How did they change?
Yeah, what changed?
Oh, my God. So, okay. So, great. So a lot changed. So this was, so they changed in the whole company. I mean, oh my God, on so many levels, we started working deeper and deeper into this organization. But I'd say one of the main things that changed was the level of conversation that could happen in that organization. That people really could, like you were talking about, like if somebody felt something was off, could they communicate it? Was there space? Was there a listening that was happening? And really, I'd say they became a listening organization. They became an organization that could listen to each other, to the people that worked for them, to their customers and clients, to their vendors. They were a listening organization. And they found that by listening, they could become a better organization. And so that was, I think, one of the fundamental things that changed. And then they were doing very, very well. CEO left, and then a lot of stuff happened, and then when they brought in a new CEO, he immediately got rid of all of the people that were coming in and doing consulting work with us and changed the culture, and as a result of that, many of the people who loved what was happening in that company left. They lost a lot of people. Yeah.
My name is Laura Tyler-Rack. This is very fascinating, so thank you for being here.
Thank you.
I'm wondering, makes a lot of sense that you don't say consciousness, because that's going to be a trigger word. Mm-hmm. But if we're out and about and we're, like, I'm looking for a new role.
You're looking for a new role?
A new professional role. What words might I use where I don't trigger people, but yet I can bring in a high level of consciousness, I can bring in a high level of getting things done.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't want to just, you know, trigger people who might have some biases initially to that
kind of
language.
I mean, I'll tell you, I used very traditional language. I used, like I said, I used things like conflict resolution, team building, communication skills. I mean, these are all just very pedestrian, non-threatening relationship building, you know, for organizations. I mean, you could go online and you could look at, you know, you could find a dozen different names for courses. So it's not about what you, I mean, you can name it anything. And then, the way in which you work with it is whether you make it a more conscious game. Like, what is it that you bring into the conversation that heightens people's awareness, their awareness of themselves? And by the way, and to this day, when I present new information, I present it with as much scientific background, data, backup, handouts, graphics that really give it teeth. You know, so if you just come in and say, hey, this is really good, or this is really cool, or this is really helpful, but if you say, you know, 30 companies have found that they were able to increase this by using some of these methods. Now you've got people's attention because, and I can relate to this, I'm a very skeptical person. I've always been. I always want, you know, data, proof, science around things. And so I respect other people's need for that, even though there's a lot of things that are not, don't necessarily have science, hard science behind it. But the more you can find that, and the more you can make the connection and give people data, the more easy it is for people to say, oh, okay, that makes sense. I'll try that out. So again, it's like, you know, how do you make it safe? How do you make it safe for people to do this work? How do you make it safe for people to confront conflict? I mean, that's one, you know, for so many people, that's like the scariest thing ever. You know, like, I'm going to really tell the truth about something. Well, how do we do this? So the more that you can begin to put things in place that really create this safety, it's amazing what can happen. Yeah. Yeah. But call it very non-threatening things. You know, team building is, you know, it's so widely accepted by even conservative companies about things that are that's needed. It's so in kind of ingrained in the culture. Communication skills, leadership skills, I mean, all of these things. But then you're coming in with, as a person who knows something, you're coming in as somebody who really knows something and somebody who can piggyback into that a higher consciousness, a higher perspective, information, exercises that really begin to open up people's mind and what's and their ideas of what's even possible in the world. Great. Yeah. Yes, baby steps. Yeah.
Could you comment on the political leadership in our country and what's going on? Now, one, you know, for example, one could make a case that a certain candidate whose name rhymes with Rump is very congruent with his values and who he is.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't, you know, haven't examined him psychologically, but from all appearances, he is who he is.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that's kind of a broad, crazy question, but there's, you know, so much going on that's so disturbing, and the kind of
let's say Trump becomes president. Let's go all the way with this. Let's say he becomes president of the United States. To me, the conscious move on that is for me to look at that and say, okay, what is it about me, us, as a culture, that absolutely requires a president that's about self-interest, greed, money, racism, and how is it that that's who we want? That's what we want. So rather than, I mean, somebody said to me the other day, it's like, well, he's really scary. I said, he's not scary. There's a lot of people out there like that. What's scary is we're choosing that if we do. So if we're choosing that, what is it about us? Because ultimately the conscious question is never about them. They're us. They're us. You know, where am I operating out of self-interest? Where am I still racist? Where am I operating out of greed? Let me find that in me and start fixing it there. And once I've got that all worked out, I'll go talk to him. But to me, it's a reflection of us. You know, it's like when I was in Europe back several years during the Bush era, and I was sort of going through my I'm embarrassed to be an American at that time. I was telling people I was Canadian, really, but then I'd say I'm from the US. But people would ask me, you know, why did they elect him a second time? And I said, oh, that's really simple, because that's who we wanted. You know, this is not, I mean, you know, it's really simple. That, I mean, wasn't who I wanted, but apparently I did because that's who I got. So then what is it that I need to see about that? What is it as a culture that we need to understand about ourselves that's because we're putting in the leadership. It's not like we're saying, hey, I'm going to go there where there's already a leader. It's an election, right? So what is it about us that requires that? And to me, that's the much more interesting conversation. And then how do we begin to address that in ourselves and with each other so that we might have some other kind of leadership that shows up in the next election? Right? I mean, you just got to get very truthful with yourself about that. But, you know, I think the biggest move of conscious leadership is to get out of looking at somebody else as not you. I mean, that's it. You know, what's showing up in your company? That's you. You know, what's showing up in your leadership? That's you. So what is it about the way you're being that makes it inevitable that this is what's showing up? And then how do you address that so that something else can show up? Because otherwise we're back to the Robert Quinn study where, you know, how come nothing changed? How come nothing changed? Well, you know, where do you want to point the finger? What is it about me that's never changed? Yeah.
I love you saying that. I wrote an article recently called Othering, about othering people.
That's a great verb.
It's a way of deflecting. That's what's going on over there has nothing to do with me.
Mm-hmm.
It's separating. So those are they conversations, and mm-hmm. I prefer the we conversations.
Yep.
Anyway, my question to you is, what is the biggest challenge you have in enrolling people into your roundtables, or into your mastermind?
The biggest challenge, I think it's really finding the right fit. So there's a couple things, for example, that we look for. One is somebody who has a vision, a business, something that they're trying to make happen in the world, that they've already got a platform, they're already developing something, or they have, could be a startup, it could be, you know, Stella's here, Stella's one of the top designers, this is hers. probably in California, amazing company that she has with you know, a number of employees, has people working for her internationally. You know, so there's people at all different levels in the group. So finding somebody who's got something that they're really bringing forward into the world. The other thing is people who have a good working knowledge of their interior. You know, they've, as I say, looked under the hood in life. You know, they've kind of taken a peek and realized they have a personal psychology. They have an emotional body. They have a good, I'd say a healthy emotional intelligence that they're operating out of. And those are two very strong components. They're also open to coaching, open to they're people who like to collaborate. They like to engage and participate and contribute. And then there's this other element, which is the chemistry right? Because this is a group that's been traveling for a couple of years now, and there's a very powerful chemistry that begins to form when a group is working together in collaboration and coming into these relationships. And so you want to make sure that anybody that you bring into the mix is going to work, the chemistry is going to work, you know, for that. It's sort of like, you know, when you're dating, you look for somebody that's got the right chemistry. It's not just, they may have all the right qualifications, but there's no chemistry, right? We've had that experience. So it's like, so it's got to have the chemistry as well. So I'd say the biggest challenge is finding that blend, because I interview a lot of people. And oftentimes it's like just recently somebody, it's like she had all the right qualifications and I just knew that it just, the chemistry wouldn't work. You know, so I directed her to a different mastermind. Yeah. So that, I think that's the biggest challenge for this. This is a very niche group. I'm working with a small group of people that I wanted to work with over time. You know, where there's a relationship that forms over time, because that that really creates some very powerful bonding. And when you understand people at that level and you've really worked with them, your ability to really be of value to each other and support each other is much heightened.
Hi, my name's Rajiv Mehta, and everything you've been saying is fascinating. At the same time, it's totally outside of my realm of knowledge, so forgive me if my question kind of, but what I've been hearing a lot about is how you work with people to help them sort of more deeply understand themselves so that they can improve their own way of being better and sort of change themselves, if you will, to have more impact in whatever.
Yes, that's part of it, yes.
And what I was wondering is, at some point, presumably, they come to discover that there are challenges that are totally outside themselves. They mm-hmm. have to come to appreciate, presumably, the limits of what's under their control.
Mm-hmm.
And how does that come up, and how do you help people sort of deal with that?
Mm-hmm.
We live in a country that has such this firm mythology that anything you want to do, you can do. And oftentimes running into that sort of appreciation,
mm-hmm.
I imagine, is quite difficult. I mean, I know it is in my work. I wonder how.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's the world, you know, and all of the challenges and all of the obstacles and everything that you have to face, what it puts you up against is your own fears, your own self-doubt, those, your own reactivity to it all. So the better you are at managing the inner game, the better generally you are at handling these things that do show up and will show up, and welcome to the world, welcome to life and all of its challenges and its messiness. And you know, we create a perfect strategic plan and just darn it, the whole economy changes right then, and you know, everything's different. So it's really a question of how do you manage the inner game so that when you're up against it and you're in reaction and all that, what can you come back to? You know, what are the practices, what are the shifts that you can create that allow you to navigate through difficult waters and through adversity and through all of that in a more elegant way, in a more conscious way? But yes, that's the world, and we don't, you know, we're not like in denial that there's a world that we deal with. And yet, there's also a very interesting relationship when you start to explore this understanding of the way that it's all interconnected, that, and I'm sure you've had this experience where all of a sudden you shift on something, and you know, it's like, if I may, you know, so, you know, Stella was sharing, she was trying to hire somebody, and she was kept hitting the wall in finding this particular hire. It was a difficult position to hire for, and when we first had the conversation, there was a lot of darn good reasons why, you know, you can't find that, it's really hard, there's not too many people doing that. I mean, there's all the reasons why. But what happened is that she generated a complete shift in inside of herself around the possibility of having it, and just completely let go of the fight and the struggle, and just absolutely got to a place of knowing, absolutely knowing the right person was going to come in. And then I think you went to your email. She went to her email. She went to her office, sat down, opened her email, and there was an application. Now, how many people have had an experience like that? Like this sort of serendipity? Okay, so we all have, you know, where it's like, you shift something here, and then all of a sudden there's this something else that begins to happen out there. And, you know, there's lots of ways that people explain it. I call it the great mystery, like that. But can you work with both worlds? Can you have your plan about what you're doing out here and the steps that you take, but also can you work the inner game so that your capacity to deal with adversity and the surprises. I mean, it's full of surprises. Life for all of us, nothing has ever turned out quite like we expected. And that's the way of it. And it's going to go that way forever. So how do you manage that? Do you just freak out, deal with it, you get stressed out? Well, a lot of people do. But is there another way of being? Some people just very naturally, mm-hmm. It's like just who they are. Their personality is like, they just roll with it, right? We know people like that. Like nothing ever really ruffles them. Nothing freaks them out. I mean, it's got to be really big to freak them out. But for most people, they have a little higher level of instability, let's just say. And so the more you're able to deal with it inside of your own being, the better you'll be able to handle those things outside, including your staff, including dealing with, relationship breakdowns. All these things are just a normal part of life. How do you deal with it? Do you deal with it in your normal reactive way? Deal with it the way your father would have, because that's what you learned? Or do you have a more creative way? A more creative way, more effective way, that's much more useful to the situation.
And maybe just picking up on a word I heard you use, control, and talking about that interior.
Yeah.
When I think about control, there are really, as a human being, there are only four things we can control. We can control our thoughts. We can control our feelings. We can control our actions, and we can control the story we tell ourselves. And to the extent that you can go to your interior and say, and using the language of one of our guests a couple of months ago, Diana Chapman, ask yourself, where am I? What story am I telling myself? Where are my thoughts? Where are my emotions? What actions am I going to take or not take? Where am I? And am I okay with where I am? And oftentimes when we find ourselves in that place of something is out of our control, we go into victim mode. And a model that we use with Future Shapers is a model of the lower quadrant is a place of victim. And it's very easy when something happens to us to go to a story, to go to some thoughts or some emotions that take us into that victim mode. And just acknowledging, I'm in victim mode right now. It's okay. And once you can settle into, it's okay, that's where I am, I'm aware that that's where I am, and you're in that place of the interior, at that point, you can let go of the story, you can let go of the thoughts, you can let go of the emotions, and then from a very conscious place, really assess what's going on. And acknowledge you never had control to begin with.
I mean, when you're facing a challenge, for everybody, when you're facing a challenge, when you're facing a difficulty, you're okay, right? I mean, except for what you're thinking. I mean, you're fine, except for what you're thinking, right? So if you can effectively shift the way you're thinking, then you can deal with it because you're fine anyway. You just don't realize that in the moment.
Yeah. My question for you, you mentioned at the beginning that you've been doing leadership development work since the 70s. And I'd like to know, what were the biggest transformations that you've gone through in doing this work, your own personal transitions, and maybe what was the trigger that led to that?
That's great, thank you. Yeah, well, I think as far as the trigger, I think because of the work I'd done prior, one of the advantages I had was really this understanding that whatever was in front of me was me, was something that I needed to learn. So every time I was working with somebody, I was hitchhiking. I was piggybacking right on the work that I was doing in order to really kind of explore it for myself and look for myself at it. I think one of the big transformations for me, and this is not to sound in any way negative, but I think that, when I was a lot younger, I had a, I'm here to change the world thing. You know, I'm going to change the world. And that has really fallen away for me. And I think that that's a real transformation over time. And I'm very happy to be free of that. For me, the question is, to be honest, I have no idea if the world is changing. I mean, a lot of people have tried to change the world, and the world is still full of everything that it's always been full of, which is wonderful things, and also greed and self-interest and war and torture and, all disease, all of that, right? So I don't even know that the curriculum that we're here for in being in a human form on the planet, in the world, is to change it. I don't know that that's what's here to be done. But I do believe that people have a sense of what they're here to do and a sense of calling and what they're passionate about. And that when they follow that authentically, that it leads to something good in general, and that we're then doing what it is that we're here to do, and that's great. So this desire that I have to really be of service in my life, and to really be of service in particular to people who are in leadership, comes from, I can, connect all kinds of dots to why it's that, but for whatever reason, it's that. For you, it's whatever it is for you. For Stella, it's like doing this incredible work that make women feel beautiful in clothes. There's all kinds of things that draw people for a variety of reasons, but if you're really connected with what is it for you, what is your core purpose? What are you here to do? And you bring that, you stand in that, and we'll find out if it changes the world. I don't know. We'll look back and we'll go, well, I'll be darned, that changed the world. Or, gee, it didn't. Say world's not much different. But it hopefully had a good impact where it did. And so I think that's one of the biggest transformations for me, and it actually feels very freeing to be sort of over the need to change the world. Maybe the world doesn't actually need changing. Maybe this is exactly what we need to be experiencing, Donald Trump and all, in order for us to look more deeply at ourselves and do our own work and have our own transformation. I apologize to anybody who is pro-Donald Trump, but everybody's entitled. I also believe everyone's entitled to their opinion, and that's good too. Yeah, I really.
Thank you very much. My name is Guillermo, and I have this question. Talking about leadership, I believe that leadership can be executed at any level of the organization.
Thank you, yes.
I believe, in my case, being a young executive in training, which is what I would like to refer myself, what could be a good starting point to demonstrate into my organization that I could be and prove to them and to myself that I could be a very good leader?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you want to speak to that? I know you also have a lot of background in this.
I'm going
to
let you start, and then I'll
and
jump
then
in if
in.
I've
okay.
got something to add that's
okay.
different than your...
Okay. Well, again, I want to sort of come back to, I think there's a couple ways I would answer that. I think one is what I was talking about leadership moments, really identifying as you go through your day, leadership moment doesn't just come from being a leader at the top. It's like seeing, where can I step in here? How can I create? Is there something that needs to be said that I normally wouldn't say? An example, like you're hanging out with people and all of a sudden somebody tells a racist joke. Okay, what do you do, right? Do you just pretend like that didn't happen? Like you don't say anything, or do you say something about that and use that as an opportunity to elevate, to bring your own courage, somebody mentioned about courage, forward, and then also to elevate somebody else's consciousness in that moment. So can I, is there something I can do just from the position that I'm in to have an impact? I think there's another piece too, in terms of like looking at how do I move into leadership, is part of self-awareness is really having an understanding of what are your strengths. What are your particular strengths, talents? What is it that you are really wired to do and to really do well? And how can you take personal responsibility for developing those capabilities, part of which is talking in your organization to whoever you need to in order to generate opportunities for you to develop those strengths or to offer them where it's useful to the company. And then also mitigating those things that are really not what you do to, you know, we all have things that we don't do real well. I mean, nobody's great at everything. So really understanding that about yourself and then making sure that you're positioned in places where you can really offer what you do well, what your strengths are. I think those are, you know, those are some places to start with it. And we do, like with in the mastermind group, we do an assessment called the Workplace Big Five. And it's like a strengths finder. It really identifies at a very deep level in a very specific way what everybody's particular strengths are, so that you can look at how do I really capitalize on what I just do naturally and what is energizing to me. I mean, imagine creating a workforce in your company where everybody is placed doing the things that are really energizing and natural for them, as opposed to doing things that are exhausting that they maybe can do, but they go home completely exhausted and you burn people out. So that's a big part of what we do, is really identify what are those strengths so that people can develop those within their organization and look for opportunities to do that. Yeah. In your organization, are there opportunities for you to look at positions you want to move into that would allow you to develop those capacities that you want?
Well, yes. At the moment, no, because I'm currently an business school student.
Okay.
But I've been in these kind of situations. Mm-hmm. And I don't take the step because of two things. And you mentioned before. One is fear. Mm-hmm. Because it's, I don't want to do that because they're going to think I'm complaining or I know better than they do. Mm-hmm. And I think fear like paralyzes you mm-hmm. sometimes. So I'm trying to learn and to understand how I can overcome this fear to achieve better things. That's mm-hmm. why my question, where should I start? Mm-hmm. Because what I really want is to light this inner flame in other people to mm-hmm. develop their awareness and everything. Mm-hmm. But sometimes finding this starting point is very difficult for me. Mm-hmm. So that's why I ask the question.
Yeah, finding the starting point, like with the right person to have the conversation with, or knowing who it is, but not knowing how to come in to the conversation.
I mean in all these terms, when, to whom, and mm-hmm. how to approach. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I call that having, going to people to have what, the term that I like to use, and I've actually borrowed this from a friend of mine, is having a conversation for possibility. A conversation for possibility. And being able to ask, you know, I have some ideas about, you know, some things that we're doing in some ways that might be useful to the organization. Is that something you'd be interested in having a conversation about? You know, and finding out if there's an interest in the conversation. So you're actually requesting permission to have the conversation. And rarely have I heard anyone say, no, I'm not interested in having a conversation about how things might improve. And then once once the door has been opened, then you can say, great, well, here's some things I've noticed, and here's some ideas I have about how we might be able to do it better. And they, you know, then there's a dialogue, and they may have reasons why they don't want to do that, that's beyond your control. But you may be bringing something that has not been thought of before, and it may be very useful to the company. And it takes a certain, we were talking about this in Mastermind the other day, the difference between arrogance and audacity. You know, so I mean, if you think about it, you know, it's like, you know, arrogance is a kind of a, I know and you don't know, it has that flavor to it. But audacity is when you don't have the courage, you know, when you're shaking in your boots about it, or you have self-doubt, like you don't know, is this the right thing? Is this help? Is this good? And then you do it anyway. And that takes some audacity, right? Some audacity to have the conversation when I don't know if this is what they need or right, but I'm going to offer it and say it. And that's a certain audacity. And there's, you know, there's something that's useful about having a certain amount of audacity that you bring forward. I mean, you see so many people today. I mean, you know, I look at a lot of millennials, they walk around, it's like they're, you know, just so defeated. You know, I see a lot of young people who walk around with a kind of a slump look, a certain defeated. I mean, I like seeing somebody with a little bit of arrogance, a little bit of audacity, because it's like sometimes you just need that to get something going. You know, it's like, you know, get it going. How do you get the conversation going? How do you get the business? You need a little audacity, you know, to do it. So just giving yourself that. It's like, do I have the audacity, you know, to do it? And then to do it in really, I mean, just from my experience of you in this little exchange, you have a very nice way about you and a very respectful way of speaking. So I don't think you're going to come across as arrogant in offering a possibility. And especially if you ask, you know, I have some ideas. Would you be interested in hearing what those are? Because then if the person says yes, they've opened the door for it, because they could say no. Well, and then if they say no, then, well, you've got your answer. They're really not interested, so why have a conversation with somebody who's not interested in hearing it? But you'll usually find that most people are interested. Thank you. Thank you for having the audacity to ask that question.
I think a couple other things I would just add.
Yeah.
So one is making sure that the organization you're working for actually values who you are, and that you've got alignment with, and you're in the right cultural, you've got the right cultural fit with the organization you're working for. The second idea that comes to mind is that something that I often talk about with leaders is that for most people working in organizations, when they get up in the morning, even subconsciously, not even their conscious mind, they start unpacking parts of themselves that they think they can't take to work. And while they're getting dressed, while they're taking a shower, brushing their teeth, commuting to work, they're leaving parts of themselves behind. So by the time they actually show up in the workplace, they might be 60% of themselves, 50%, 40% of themselves. All of their colleagues have gone through that same unpacking process. So they show up at work and they're a percentage of their whole self. And so what I would say in response to your question is, make that a conscious decision. What parts of me aren't I going to take to work? Because when you're unconsciously or consciously leaving parts of yourself behind, those are parts of you that aren't showing up, that you're not giving your organization, you're not giving those who are responsible for giving you leadership opportunities to know who you really are. Welcome.
Anybody else? Hi, my name is Stella, and I would actually like to comment on what you just said. I think part of being in Susan's mastermind, which has been and continues to be an amazing transformative experience for me as a business leader, is our personas. Mm-hmm. And our personas are a result of our stories. Mm. So if we show up at work and unpack before we go to work, that all ties in with what our beliefs are. And it starts at that really deep level of really getting to know who you are as a person, dare to dive in. That's the ultimate beginning of everything. that eventually will allow you to have all the results that you're seeking in life. You have to get real with yourself and not be afraid of who you are and have the audacity to actually show up that way. And if you remain natural in who you really are, you will not be offensive to anybody, because have you ever met somebody that really shows up authentically that you don't embrace? You're actually drawn to them. And I think we should all have the courage to do more of it. Mm-hmm. And it takes courage to be vulnerable, because we all have our soft spots and areas we don't like to show. But if we dare to bring that with us, mm-hmm. it will open up conversation and actually create the community that we seek.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. And I think, you know, what one of the things that people, I mean, you can look for yourself at leaders that you admire. They generally tend to be people who are just so completely themselves, you know, just so completely themselves. I think even a lot of why people admire Donald Trump is that element. I mean, you know, whether you like what he stands for or not, people admire somebody who just stands up there with no apology for who they are. Want to make them president of the United States, regardless of their policies or background. But there's something that absolutely is compelling to people about somebody who shows up in a way that is unapologetically themselves.
Other questions?
There's a quick comment just to cover what you just said about Trump showing up as himself.
Yeah.
At the gym today, they were showing one of those news stations, and they were showing Trump saying, well, we've got Little Rubio and Lying Cruz or something, some little nicknames.
Yeah.
And those nicknames were sticking. Mm-hmm. So sure. He's pointing out, you know what, other people are showing up not authentic.
Mm-hmm.
So is that working for us?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so interesting. Yeah, very, very interesting. You know, I went to this this conference where the keynote speaker was Brené Brown. Oh, the two keynote speakers were Brené Brown and Hillary Clinton. Okay. Right. I mean, like, if you don't know who Brené Brown is, she right, you do. She's written some amazing books and does some good TED Talks on the whole conversation about vulnerability and authenticity. So she comes up, she does this talk. I want to tell you, it was inspiring. She's so, I mean, oh my God, here's somebody speaking in front of 5,000 women. It was a women's conference, 5,000 women. And she just laid it out. I mean, she was laying it out about everything. She was so incredibly frank about herself and what some of the things that she's been struggling and dealing with, and kind of, you know, having to read criticisms about her in the paper because people comment on her weight and, you know, things like, I mean, all kinds. She was just so frank and inspiring and, you know, all that, and very motivational. She gets off the stage. The next person is Hillary. Okay. You really see the difference between somebody who is remarkably authentic and somebody who is a very well-presented, very experienced politician. You know, she does a very good presentation. She's very direct. She's got, you know, all that going on. I mean, you know, all that. But the difference was glaring, and I was kind of looking around to see, did anybody else get that? Anyone else just kind of struck by the contrast here between somebody going up with their prepared speech and their, you know, no matter what you asked, what she was asked, she got back to her talking points, right, rather than really answer something genuinely. And it was just remarkable. But again, it's like, you know, Brené Brown's not running for president.
Mm.
Yes. Too bad. And Hillary is. So, yeah, it's just interesting. I mean, you look at who is our leadership. And, you know, we tend to be very critical of it, but I really love to bring it back to, that's our lead. We've chosen this. This is what's coming in because this is what we have attracted. So what is this saying about who we are rather than who they are?
Other question?
In the New York Times this Sunday, there was a very interesting article on how would Trump come across if Trump were a woman? Just imagine that. So this is, you know, this is the challenge. I love Brené Brown. Bringing that level of vulnerability into a leadership position in a corporation, that might work. it's challenging. And I think women leaders do face a different level of challenge than men in terms of bringing their whole selves into the workplace, and particularly bringing vulnerability into the workplace and making that work to have them be perceived as leaders. Because we have a culture that identifies male qualities as leadership qualities.
Yes,
and if we
true.
Don't recognize that as women who might be aspiring to leadership positions, I think we do ourselves a disservice. So it's the challenge is to be authentic, to know yourself, and to know that you're operating in a world that operates by some values that you'll be judged by.
Yes, yeah, beautiful. And thank you for bringing that up, because you can see the way that, you know, within the culture, women, particularly, you know, starting in the 80s, was a very masculine, very male-driven leadership model. And so women had, I mean, you know, look at the way we dressed. I mean, it was business suits. Women, I knew women wore in ties. You know, we cut our hair really short. I mean, it was, you know, a way of showing up that was very masculine and trying to emulate that. So the only problem with that is it wasn't bringing anything new to the table. You know, and I remember this one moment, and it was actually when I started working with the bankers, because I found myself in a room of 36 people. The only women in the room was one executive vice president and me, and everybody else was a man. And I found myself just sort of almost automatically, unconsciously, matching the masculine energy in the space, you know, in terms of sort of demeanor and conversation and banter and, you know, a lot of that. And I remember there was this moment, you know, so we talk about these moments, right, these leadership moments. And there was a moment where I realized this room does not need any additional testosterone. we got lots of that going on here. I mean, that is not what is needed from me to add, to bring something different into the space. And I remember kind of moving from being very forward to literally physically kind of sitting back in a more relaxed way, softening my tone, and then bringing in a conversation that was about feelings. I remember I asked this question because there was an issue between two executive vice presidents. And I said, well, you know, when that happened, how did you feel about it? And, you know, what I heard was, well, people shouldn't, a lot of philosophizing, you know, well, one shouldn't do this and people should, and you know, I expect, it was very cerebral. It was not about feeling. And so I asked the question again, and it kind of went the same way. And finally, I went over to the wall and I put up a flip chart and I wrote down feeling words like frustrated, disappointed, sad, angry, like that. And you know, made like a menu. And he looked over at it and he went, oh, let's see, I was frustrated and I was angry. So I, okay, great. So let's start there. And then, you know, kind of facilitated a conversation. Did you know he felt that way? Did you, you know, it was like that. Okay. For the rest of the day, every time I asked the feeling question, you saw 30 heads turn and look at the list. One of those and one of those. But again, it was beginning to introduce a conversation that wasn't like the male conversation. And it, what they found, what was very interesting, was that when they began to talk about it, they got much more real, of course, with each other. It was sort of the next level of real, from my opinion to how I was feeling. And then they were able to have more compassion for each other and then actually resolve a lot of these differences. So they found that talking about feelings was not touchy. They used to tease me. It's like, yeah, that feely touchy stuff. I'd say you're gonna do that feely touchy stuff with us, you know. But they actually found that when they did that, they were able to resolve these issues that they had been doing this with forever, right? You know, and that actually cost them time and money. And, you know, you can always tie it back, coming back to your thing, tying it back to goals, tying it back to effective use of time and money and, you know, all that. So they began to embrace this as just really a way of speaking about things. And it actually became much more part of the dialogue in that organization. Yeah, I really appreciate you bringing up, because I think it's sort of the issue whose time has come. And we'll see. Maybe we'll have a woman president and see what that does.
All this is making me think of, I think there's such a transition right now going on with businesses and leadership, and that women are coming more into being authentic about being feminine in the workplace. Mm-hmm. But also there's this whole shift from solopreneurs and solo leadership, top-down leadership, to a more collaborative approach. Mm-hmm. And I'm really curious about that as a question. I've been building my own business called Lead by Wisdom, and in a very synchronistic and unusual way, three former colleagues of mine sent me a website to the same company. All these three colleagues didn't know each other, and from all parts of the nation. This was about 2 weeks ago. Well, I looked into the organization,
sure,
and talking about the notion of using the word consciousness, mm-hmm, that is what they used over and over again. Mm-hmm. And I scoured the website and read all of the bios and was just stunned by the variety of the people who were working there. One was a monk who was teaching mindfulness training, and another was a strategic planner, and another was, you know,
exactly,
on and on.
Yeah.
And honestly, I was in a conundrum because my colleagues were saying, this sounds like you, Joyce. This sounds like the company that you're creating. Mm. So my question to you is, building your own business, and I've built two on the East Coast, successful. But
this kind of a company, this kind of
this
consciousness
kind
and
of
business? Or
yeah, consciousness, uh-huh, and business. Mm-hmm. Back then, the Chamber of Commerce looked at me like, you're going to do what kind of, you know? Oh, I'm trying to instill intuition and logic in the workplace, you know, and they looked at me like I was crazy in the 70s or early 80s. Anyway, now I'm at a point where I don't want to do it by myself.
Yeah.
I really want a team. Mm. So when this came up 2 weeks ago, I was like, my ready-made team, maybe? Uh-huh. So I just had my interview this morning, and I really am faced with an unusual energetic around building your own business, having spirit literally encourage me to bring out various teachings in the world, mm-hmm, that I believe are really important in leadership, things that don't get talked about a lot, like consciously choosing power with versus power over, and more about integrity that you guys are bringing up. So my question is, how do you bridge between the collaborative desire and the solopreneurship of building your own business? Mm-hmm. If you could address that, I'd really appreciate it. Mm-hmm.
Be interesting, you know, kind of be interesting to see how, because from what you've said, I kind of liked what you said about, wow, I've got my ready-made, there's a ready-made team that I could be part of. You know, and again, kind of speaking to what you were talking about, leadership can happen at any level. It's like, why is it so important that I have my own business? Who cares on some level? It's mm-hmm. like, if you come back to, what is it that I'm really here to do? How can I be of service? Where can I be most effective doing that? I think a darn good place to start is anybody else already got something going that I can participate with. I think that's an absolutely legitimate place to begin to look for where can I have an impact? Is somebody already constructed the game so that I don't have to like do all that groundwork to build, like there's a business and at what level can I come in and contribute to that? So there could be a very interesting conversation in which you become part of a team that already exists. And since you're clearly drawn to this collaborative, it's like, you know, does it have to be yours? You know, do you have to be the one who started it? What's the value of that? For you, not to say that there isn't one, there could be lots of reasons why you want to do it that way. But if that's not, you know, a lot of times for people, that's very ego-driven. So, you know, there's always something running the show, right? Is it your ego running the show, or is it something deeper? You know, your essence, your values, what you really care about, what matters to you at a deeper level. And if that's what's running the show, it will, you know, what I'm kind of drawn to myself and have done my whole life is where's the juice? You know, where am I energized? And I pay very big attention to that. Am I energized by participating with this group of people? I've been an employee at different times in my life because I was very energized by a game that somebody else had invented that I wanted to go support that vision. And I became a major person in helping them really grow. I mean, we doubled it in the 3 years that I worked for them, and that was by large my contribution. So to me, it's like not a question of, you know, well, is it my company? Is it a collaborative? Is it an employee? But where can I really have the best impact to do what I feel drawn to do in the world? And where do I feel energized to play? I pay very big attention to where's the energy. And you lit up notably when you talked about that. Like there was you literally lit up, perked up. So to me, I pay attention to, something is really speaking to you about that. Yeah, and to find collaborative players that have your values, that are doing that work in the world. You loved the diversity of background and skills that the people had. You can bring some to that, and why not see if there's a game for you to play there? And if not, is that a model that you would like to duplicate in your own way and, you know, find that kind of collaboration? Like, okay, a monk. I need a monk. I gotta go find me a monk. Strategic planner, need one of those. But finding people, you know, who have your values and what energizes you about it, because it may or may not be that particular game that you want to play, that group rather, that business. But it's showing you clearly something that turns you on. And you could absolutely borrow anything from that to generate something of your own, which I'm sure you will.
And then maybe to take that a step further, to ask yourself, and really building on Suzanne's comments, what brings me joy? Is it developing the products and services that are being offered in the marketplace? Is it the pursuit of finding the clients? Or is it actually delivering the services to the clients? And mm-hmm. so thinking in each of those areas of business, what is it that brings you the most joy?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and in the workplace, that assessment I was talking about, mm-hmm. what it does is it identifies strengths, but then it identifies what are your energizers. Because those are, like what he just described, are three very different capabilities. Mm-hmm. And somebody might find they love the sales and marketing end of it, but are not like the delivery end of it is not their thing, or vice versa. So, you know, can you really capture what is energizing for you and then find collaborators who have the other strengths? What tends to happen when people form partnerships is instead of bringing in the other strengths that are needed, they bring in people that they like, who are, you know, tend to be like themselves. It's like, oh, you like to do that. I like to do that too. Okay, now we got two people who like to do that and nobody who likes to do the thing that needs to, the other thing that needs to get done. So we've got two people who love to develop product and deliver it, and nobody who likes to do the sales and marketing. Oops, oopsie poopsie. Yes. Missed out on that one. And I've actually seen partnerships absolutely fall apart on that note. So identifying really clearly what are your strengths and your energizers, and then bringing people in who have that and have some track record with that. Yeah, okay, thank you.
Well, thank you all for being here this evening. And thank you for being our guest.
Thank you. This is really fun. I really enjoyed it. Thank you, all of you, for your contributions to the conversation. It made it really fun and enjoyable for me to be here as well. So thank you. Yay. Go out and do good work.
So with that, thank you, Gladstone, for the use of the space. Thank you for coming tonight. Appreciate it. Come again.